I don't think it's quite there yet. Moving on over into team moves. There have been a lot of them recently. Damaga announced that that he was a free agent. He was tweeting about it. Some people were like, hey, what's up, Dima? So he went on and talked on a couple of talk shows, and turns out Damaga said he wasn't being paid by his former team, MTW. A couple of news sites came out and speculated that MTW might be dissolving due to lack of funds and ability to pay for their players and their other expenses. And just yesterday, I believe it was, MTW came out and released this statement. Now, this is loosely translated off of Reddit, in fact, but because they posted it in German. But they said, "We are sad to announce today that after 15 successful years, MTW will be closed down. The last weeks show that the business model of esports clans does not work anymore in its current form. Running a sustainable and stable business was no longer possible under these circumstances, and that is why we have reached the decision to close this chapter of MTW for now. If and when the next chapter will be written remains to be seen. As soon as we can guarantee again that a sustainable existence is possible and that we can offer the support to our teams that they deserve, MTW will return. Until then, we wish all the best to our former teams and partners. We want to thank all of our fans who have made Mortal Teamwork something special over the years." So it's always very sad to see a team go, certainly one like MTW that has been around for so long. Kevin, MTW was a big force back in the Warcraft 3 days. Definitely. I know that you've interacted with them a lot through the years. Tell us about your thoughts on this announcement.
Yeah, it makes me sad, man. As you said, MTW was one of those organizations as a player, certainly as an up-and-coming player, you wanted to be on a team like MTW, like SK, like Fnatic. Those were the solid teams out there, so to see MTW gone makes me quite sad. Just to give you guys a brief history, a couple of the players that were on MTW, guys like Kiwikaki, guys like Satini, and they had also very good Warcraft players who didn't really make the transition. But what about this guy, MTW Who?
Who?
Who? His nickname actually was Who. He was the world champion in Warcraft 3 in 2008. Fantastic Orc player. Also had guys like Winner from Lithuania, one of the best undead players in the world. And DD8 as well, fantastic Night Elf from Bulgaria it was. And also they had a very good German roster. Guys like who are considered in the German scene at least legends. Guys like Taker, The Pig, Protoss, Davin, Lesh, all really big names for Warcraft 3 guys. So it makes me sad to see them gone, Ben. Certainly because in StarCraft 2 they kind of started out promising as well. I mean, they had the Muslim, they had Dimaga. Those were, in my opinion, in the early days of Wings of Liberty, the best two players in Europe. That's a cool picture, by the way. Of
the Muslim's best Roddy pose.
Yeah. No, but I mean, those two, they won the first Dota Cup. So MTW started off strong as well in StarCraft. After that, they did have a couple of notable names on their roster. I mean, on a certain moment, they had TT1 on the roster. Who am I forgetting? Night End, of course, was part of MTW as well for a while. But yeah, they never really took off.
One of the craziest things is it was just like a year ago that you and I were in Kiev talking to Damaga about his history and being a pro gamer. And he was expressing how happy he was with MTW, how excellent his arrangement was with the team. And it just blew me away. It absolutely floored me to hear about this. But that said, it's not all doom and gloom on the team moves front, as several players have recently found new teams. And I think it's really pretty exciting. Satini going over to Cascade Gaming. Killer leaving Dignitas, we know now that it was to join Clarity Gaming. Delphi and Nomi join Next Multigaming. Moro has signed with Western Wolves. And just yesterday we learned that Yu-Gi-Oh! Is joining Team Root. I want to ask you, just off the cuff, what's that all about? That's a kind of an interesting acquisition.
Well, I mean, I think it's safe to say that he's a really good player. I do not know the ins and outs why we actually went for him, but I do think we're going to see a lot of good stuff from Yu-Gi-Oh!
Oh, you should see that. You definitely saw his last GSTL performance, right? Because some would say that he beasted that performance.
That's why we took him. No, I mean,
he's a beast in StarCraft, like Kevin's a beast in the gym.
I don't want to act like cats. I'm not the captain, so you're gonna have to ask him some questions to
Cats. All right. Well, that'll be a question for Paulo at a later time. I am very happy though to see some of these guys finding teams. Andre, you had an interesting point to make though about maybe the other side of the coin when it comes to players and teams.
It's actually really unfortunate. Players like Damaga. Think how long it took Morrow to find a team that he actually liked, and that's a big problem. I'm finding that, you know, teams like MTW that were able to support these very high class players are dropping out, and on top of that, we have more and more players just joining the scene of being unsponsored. And that's a big problem. I feel like that's going to really detract from all these players going into this pro player pool and trying their luck out at being in this scene. And I think that's just detrimental to growth, of course.
Could be. I would have to say that I think the more separation you have between the top teams and everybody else, I think that makes it a more competitive environment, though. And I certainly think that when you create separation between the professional level and the amateur level, there is growth there. That does create desire, right? It creates that desire to want to be not the unsponsored amateur guy, but the sponsored pro guy.
Yeah, I just think it's just a question and where your threshold is of how many spots should exist for pro players. And I feel like players like Mauro, players like Damaga should be on a team ASAP. People should be knocking on their doors saying, what do you want? And we're not currently at that state. Of course, that's what I would love. But I just feel like, I don't know, there's just not enough teams to do what needs to be done.
Just to follow up on that, that's actually something that in Warcraft 3 was the case for a long time. It was always like the moment one guy would leave a team, it's like, oh my god, who's going to pick him up? It was like inevitable that one of those WC2L teams and a team like MTW, for instance, would always be able to pick up those guys. But then later on, the crazier the salaries got at certain teams, like Meet Your Makers came out and they paid ridiculous salaries, like salaries that are similar to what the top guys in StarCraft 2 get right now as well. And back then it was even not that much social media exposure. And like the more the salaries went up in certain teams, the harder it went for certain other guys to get a team. Well, 2-3 years before the salaries went that crazy, it really never was that case. So I do understand that you're concerned about that. And I hope that Demaga, of course, is going to end up well. And I'm not too worried about Demaga, but I am worried about this perhaps happening more in the future.
I hate to branch it off a little bit, but don't you think some players in the scene are being overpaid for where the current scene is? I know it's great that some of these players are getting that salary, but for where esports is, I don't think, you know,
that's a difficult question. That's a really difficult question. And I think it might even open up a discussion point for a later date about transparency when it comes to that kind of thing. Something that blew me away a couple of weeks ago when it was announced that Parting was going to a KESPA team was that they just came right out and said, hey, this is what he's getting paid. He's getting like $9,000 a month. For a period of time. And that's like, whoa.
Nine months.
Nobody's ever done that before. Like, it's such a secret what players are making. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? So
I think it's a good thing, but then I think that casters are going to have to be much more open about what they earn as well. Because you cannot just expect that player salaries are public while casters do not want to say how much they charge for a certain event.
I mean, if you look at every other sport, it's almost the same exact way. People are very open about those negotiations and contracts. I mean, it was actually recently reported like just a couple hours ago that Hyun's asking for $2,500 a month plus travel for any team, and no team is still not picking up. And this is Hyun. This is a GSL finalist. This guy is absolutely insane. He's got personality. He's really fun. And it's an incredibly talented Zerg, one of the best Brood War Berserks to come over back in 2011. So, I mean, this is the actual state of which things are. And I do think people should be more open about their contract negotiations, even though, yeah, we're still in a developing stage. I think that's eventually the goal we have to get towards.
Yeah, we are in a development stage, but also this could turn into a player's type union, and standardization is across the board of the type of tier level these players are and if they want to unite in some way. And you could have the same thing happen for the commentators and a talent type union. This is how unions form, to have standards and practices for all the people involved. But that's ways away. We're not there yet, but this is those types of problems and scenarios that have led to unions.
Yeah, but to bring it all back, you always have to ask the question, can the industry support that kind of a thing?
Yeah.
Can our industry support casters demanding $10,000 per event, or players demanding $2,500 per month, or you know, whatever it would be? There are a lot of teams
it's already kind of funny that we compare those two things. $10,000 for a weekend, or one of the best players in the world for $2,500 a month.
That's a completely...
The funny thing that we put those two things in the same perspective is kind of ludicrous. No. I think.
I don't know. I'll take $10,000.
We'll probably. There you go.
That's a good thought. That's a good thought to take into the break, guys. We're going to take a very, very short commercial break here on The Pulse. When we get back, we are going to be talking about tournament results. There have been a lot of them. Iron Squid, IEM, GSL, and more. Don't go anywhere. The Pulse will be right back.